Hello students, so I welcome you once again to the session on metal forming and tool design. So in the previous class we had discussed about what is extrusion, what are the different types of extrusion, and why lubrication is necessary, defects, and how deformation takes place, and what do you mean by seamless tubes and extrusion of seamless tubes, and different process parameters relating to extrusion. So again, a quick review. So this is extrusion. It's a process by which a block of metal is reduced in cross section by forcing it to flow through a die under high pressure. And extrusion, keep in mind, extrusion is a single pass process. So different types of extrusion. The classification is direct extrusion, indirect extrusion, cold or impact extrusion, and hydrostatic extrusion. So these are some of the examples made by extrusion process. So in direct extrusion, a simple thing that we have to remember is the direction of RAM travel is same as direction of the extrusion extruded product. So the direction will remain same for the extruded product as well as for the RAM. So that is how you can identify direct extrusion. We also have a special dummy block over here, okay, in case of direct extrusion. Next we have indirect extrusion. Over here you can and indirect extrusion. So, and one more thing is the billet will remain stationary in the case of indirect extrusion, and hence the force required is much lower when compared with direct extrusion. But the RAM is not a complete solid block. It has the die. So careful considerations has to be taken while designing the RAM. So next we had discussed about the extrusion pressure versus RAM travel. Then we have hydrostatic extrusion, wherein there is some liquid. Okay, a pressurized liquid medium is used to deform metal rather than applying direct load on the billet. So negligible friction will be present, occurs between work metal and the container wall. So hence, less force is required for this particular hydrostatic extrusion process. So advantage of using this hydrostatic extrusion process is it gives good dimensional accuracy and surface finish. And even brittle materials can be extruded easily because of high pressure. So next we have impact extrusion. So the metal is kept inside a small cavity. Over here you can see a rapidly moving punch deforms the metal, and this is usually performed in cold state. So usually the material that is used that can be deformed in using impact extrusion is lead, tin, aluminium, copper, etc. Next we had studied about the analysis of extrusion, wherein we discussed the three types of metal flow. So where in the first case, this over here you can see, this is the first case. This type happens in homogeneous flow pattern, is found in absence of friction at the billet container die interface. To obtain this type of flow pattern, it is necessary for there to be fully lubricated between the material container die interfaces. Next, type B, this pattern is obtained in homogeneous material when friction along the interfaces exist. So a separate metal zone is formed between the die face and the container wall, you can see over here, known as the dead metal zone. And finally, the type C, and this type of pattern is the result of non-uniform temperature distribution in a billet or a non-homogeneous material property. So the high shear zone in the material extends farther back to form more extended dead zone as a result of high container metal friction. So these are the three types of metal flow found. And then we have the different types of lubricants, that is glass, as well as we have lanolin, graphite, soap, tallow, etc. Then we have the different types of extrusion equipment. So hydraulic, mechanical, horizontal, as well as vertical die presses. So these are the different features of a simple extrusion die. We have the deformation zone from A to B, where the cross section gradually decreases from A towards B, and proper design is important to obtain desired shape and accurate dimensions. So AB is the deformation zone, alpha is called as the half angle, half diangle, and more the alpha, more will be the friction, and lower the alpha, lower will be the material moment. So BC is the bearing load. Okay, you can see over here BC, the constant cross section. Here no reduction of work happens, only frictional drag will be present. So CD is the back relief angle. You can see over here there is a small opening at the end of the die. So over here this is provided for metal expansion. So metal expands slightly as the work leaves the die. Okay. So next we have extrusion of hollow sections or extrusion of seamless pipes. So extrusion is best method for making seamless pipes. So usually pipes and tubes are manufactured using welding, but in this case we can manufacture or produce pipes without any seams. So that is without any discontinuity. So while extruding a hollow section, a mandrel is attached to the ram. You can see over here the mandrel is attached to the ram, and the mandrel is pierced till the entrance of die opening. In the second figure you can see the mandrel is completely pierced, and you can see hollow cross section being extruded. Hence long hollow tube extrusion is possible. So different types of extrusion defects: internal cracking, piping, surface defects. Okay, so these are the different defects in extrusion. So with this concept we'll move on to the next process, that is rolling. So what do you mean by rolling? It is a metalworking process of reducing the thickness or changing the cross section of a workpiece by means of compressive force. So in the case of extrusion, we are also applying compressive force, and also we are reducing the cross section, but in a single pass. Whereas in the case of rolling, it can be multiple passes. So rolling is the process of reducing the thickness or changing the cross section of a workpiece by means of compressive forces exerted by a set of rotating rolls. So over here you can see we have a small video over here wherein the metal is continuously fed between these two rollers and it is flattened. The cross section is reducing. You can see over here the cross section is slowly reducing as it passes between the rolls. So just like a kneaded atta is rolled between the flat plate and the rolling pin, so you are reducing the cross section of the metal. So in this particular rolling chapter, we'll be discussing about what is rolling, the introduction, the classification of rolling process, different types of rolling mills, defects in roll products, and finally rolling variables. What are the different variables that affects the final rolled product? So in operation, as the workpiece passes between the two constantly rotating rolls, the workpiece is subjected to high compressive force from the squeezing action of the rolls on the workpiece. In addition, the workpiece also subjected to surface shear stresses as a result of friction between the rolls and the workpiece metal. As a result, the workpiece is plastically deformed to the desired shape. Okay, so flat products are produced by cylindrical shaped rolls, while profiles are produced by grooved or shaped rolls. So you provide any grooves on this particular rolls, you can even roll a desired cross section. Okay, so over here you can see this is, there are two rolls, the upper and lower rolls. We have this part is the rolled metal and this is the cast ingot or billet. Okay, so metal is initially pushed into the space between two rolls. You can see over here this is the space between two rolls. The metal is pushed literally, therefore once the roll takes a bite into the edge of the material, so once this metal is caught by these two rolls, the metal gets pulled in by friction between the surfaces of the rolls and the material. The material is subjected to high compressive force as it is squeezed and pulled along by rolls. It is subjected to compressive force. You can see these two are the rolls and the cross section is reduced. This is a process to deal with material in bulk in which the cross section of material is reduced and its length is increased. The final cross section is determined by the impression cut in the roll surface through which the material passes and to which it is compressed. So this is the actual rolling operation, and you can see the crystal structure, the change in the crystal structure. This is the unworked crystals you can see over here, distributed uniformly. And again, even though the crystals are elongated, the distribution becomes more equal as it passes through the rolls. So there are two types of rolling. Again, the one is hot rolling and cold rolling. So that we will be discussing at a later stage. So next is sequence of operations for obtaining different shapes. So there are different types of nomenclature for rolled products. The first one is bloom. It is the first product obtained from breaking down of ingots. A bloom has a cross-sectional range ranging from 150 mm square to 250 mm square, or sometimes 250 by 300 mm rectangle also. Next we have billets. A billet is the next product rolled from a bloom. From bloom we'll get the billet. Billets vary from 50 mm to 125 mm square. Next we have slab. So billet is a square cross section. Slab is a rectangular cross section with thickness ranging from 50 to 150 mm. The thickness is 50 to 150 mm and is available in lengths of up to 1.5 meters. Next we have plates. Plate is generally 5 mm or thicker and is 1 or 1.25 meters in width and 2.5 meters in length. Then we have sheet. A sheet is up to 4 mm thick and is available in same width and length as a plate. The thickness goes on reducing as we move further. Flats. Flats are available in various thickness and widths and are long strips of material of specified cross section. Foil. It's a very, very thin sheet. Then we have bars. Bars are usually cross-section and of several meters length. They are common stock, that is raw material for capstan and turretlets. So whatever you use in your machine shop, those are called as bars. Then we have wires. Wires are length, usually in coil form, of a small round cross-section, the diameter of which specifies the size of the wire. So these are some nomenclatures. The bloom, using bloom we'll get the structural shape such as eye shape as well as the rails. Then slabs, used to make plates as well as sheets as well as coils. Billets can be converted into bars or rods. So this is an example of a roller, a simple roller usually used for rolling sheet metals. Okay. So over here you can see these are the two rollers. The gap between the two rollers can be adjusted using this particular mechanism at the top. You can see over here we have some engravings at the top. Just by rotating this nut, we can control the gap between the rollers. You can see over here the nut is at the top. Just by adjusting the, by rotating this nut, we can adjust the gap between the two rollers. So this is a continuous casting and rolling operation. You can see over here the lateral tracking and steel temperature control. Then next we have the cast component into the mold and continuously fed between the rollers, and you have the final rolled product. Okay. So over here there are different mechanisms, and these are the different applications. So fuselage of aircraft is 1 mm thick aluminium alloy sheet. Skin thickness can vary up to 1.8 mm. Okay. So some beverage cans that you use regularly, the chocolate wrappers. Okay. So these are the different applications of rolling. And over here you can see thread rolling operation being performed. You have the die over here. You can see this is the die as well as this is the die, and we have this job. You can see this is the job wherein the thread is being created using the dies. So next, classification of rolling. Based on the working temperature, rolling can be classified into two types. One is hot rolling and the other is cold rolling. You can see over here The process remains same, only thing the temperature changes. In hot rolling, the workpiece material is initially heated above the recrystallization temperature, that is, we call it as RCT temperature, recrystallization temperature, and then passed between shaped rollers. Okay, these are the two rollers to obtain the desired product. High temperatures help the coarse grained, brittle and porous structure of the ingot or cast metal to break down into a rod structure with finer grain size. You can see over here, they have explained, they have shown the grain structure. It is coarse and bigger, and you can see over here fine grain structure and uniform distribution. And it is very important to note that as the material is worked, its temperature should be monitored to make sure it remains above the recrystallization temperature. If the temperature drops below this temperature, the material must be reheated before rolling is continued. Since it is being passed continuously through multiple rollers, the recrystallization temperature has to be maintained constantly. The final finishing temperature of the workpiece is usually between 50 to 100 degrees Celsius, that is 50 to 100 degrees Celsius above the recrystallization temperature. Okay. So, hot rolling, just a quick review. The distinctive result of hot rolling is not a crystallized structure, but simultaneous dislocation, propagation, and softening process with or without recrystallization during rolling. The dominant mechanism depends on temperature and grain size. In general, recrystallized structure becomes finer with lower deformation temperatures and faster cooling rates. And materials of superior properties are obtained by controlling the final temperature, that is the finishing temperature. So hot rolling offers several advantages. So higher working temperatures results in finer grain structure, which in turn imparts better strength and toughness to the work material. The flow stresses are low, so forces and power requirements are relatively low, and even very large work pieces can be deformed with the equivalent of reasonable size. So surface oxidation occurs at higher temperatures, result in scaling. A disadvantage. Scaling is a disadvantage. Ductility is high, hence large deformations can be made up to 99% reductions, and even complex work pieces can be generated. The major disadvantages of hot rolling. So as I said, surface oxidation, it occurs at higher temperatures, resulting in scaling. The scale thus formed has to be removed by an operation called pickling. Next, we have heating the workpiece above its recrystallization temperature is expensive, and maintaining the temperature is also difficult. Also, non-uniform heating results in cracking and tearing of rolled parts. So non-uniform cooling of workpiece will induce residual stresses. So these are some of the advantages as well as disadvantages of hot rolling. So next, what do you mean by cold rolling? So cold rolling is usually carried out below the recrystallization temperature. Slightly at an elevated temperature, but below the recrystallization. The starting material for cold rolling is usually pickled hot rolled work. So again, hot working is necessary before starting with cold rolling. However, in case of certain alloys, say for example, copper alloys, it is not necessary. The material is directly from the cast state. Cold rolling process imparts desirable metal qualities that cannot be obtained by hot rolling. Good surface finish, scale-free surface, close dimensional tolerance, and better mechanical properties are some of the advantages of going for cold rolling. So cold rolling usually follows hot rolling. So once hot rolling is complete, then we go with cold rolling. A material subjected to cold rolling strain hardness considerably. So there will be some amount of strain hardness. Dislocation density increases, and when a tensile test is performed on this strain hardened material, higher stress will be needed to initiate and maintain plastic deformation. So yield strength stress increases. However, the ductility of the material drops because of the higher initial dislocation density. Similarly, the strength coefficient rises and strain hardening drops. Grains become elongated in the direction of the major deformation. So what are the advantages? So the first and foremost is workpiece need not be heated. That means it should be heated, but we need not worry about the recrystallization temperature. It is free from surface scale formation due to low temperature processing. Cold rolling results in loss of ductility and increase in strength and hardness of the rolled metal. Very thin products can be rolled. The final properties of the workpiece can be closely controlled and grain size can be controlled before annealing. And usually the surface finish is quite good when compared with hot rolling. Next we have some disadvantages. The major disadvantages being ductility of the material decreases due to strain hardening, thus making more brittle. Internal stresses are induced in the cold rolled products, which has to be removed by heat treatment process. And cold rolling cannot reduce the thickness of the workpiece as much as hot rolling process in a single pass. Okay. So next we have a table comparing the hot rolling as well as the cold rolling, a comparison. So hot rolling is performed above the recrystallization temperature and cold rolling is done below the recrystallization temperature. Cold rolling doesn't mean we are performing it at room temperature. It is slightly at elevated temperature. Regarding the surface finish, hot rolling results in lower surface finish when compared with cold rolling. And the hot rolling produces semi-finished items like bloom billets, etc. Whereas cold rolling produces finished items like plates, sheets, coils, etc. So grain structure, fine grain structure in case of hot rolling and elongated grain structure in case of cold rolling. So cold rolling requires less load for deformation, whereas hot rolling requires less load for deformation, whereas cold rolling requires more load. Annealing is usually not required for hot rolling, and annealing is required for cold rolling. So this is about the classification of rolling, but that is hot rolling as well as cold rolling. Next, we will be discussing about rolling mills. Before that, I would like to ask Chetan sir to give any inputs regarding the portions that we have covered till now.
Thank you, Dr. Nikhil. Students, see, any subject for that matter, you must learn it from practical perspective. And the metal forming is one such subject where it touches our life in day-to-day affairs. For example, the coins that we carry in our pocket are the products of metal forming process. But that metal forming process is not there in the syllabus. That is called a separate coining process. That is basically a combination of press and sheet metal forming. The metal forming, as I had mentioned earlier, it has two components. One is bulk metal forming, which is there in your syllabus, and another one is sheet metal forming, which we are dealing with also. Normally, sheet metal forming comes under press working, whereas bulk metal forming, we have rolling, extrusion, forging, and other. You may ask me one question, that is, sir, what are the products? If I start listing the products, it will be fairly large. For example, crankshafts are manufactured by forging process. Sheets, rods, and other things are manufactured by rolling process. Extrusion process has different kind of cross section and long bars. Whatever is the product of this bulk metal forming, it is directly used for day-to-day affairs. So you have to look around and just gauge, okay, this is manufactured by which process? Everything is, most of the things rather, manufactured by sheet metal. Of course, I wanted to talk on rolling, but at the end of this class, I will touch upon that. That is, there is a one public sector unit called Midhani in Hyderabad. That Midhani stands for Mishra Dhatu Nigam. And Mishra Dhatu Nigam, there is a very, very big rolling unit. And it has the cluster of around 11 rolls, where in ingot is directly converted into sheet metal, and those sheet metals are used for aircraft industries. This is my just input, but I will tell about that at a later stage.
Thank you, sir. So So with that, we'll continue further. So basically, we are talking about the rollers. So a rolling mill is a machine or a factory for shaping the workpiece metal by passing through a set of rotating shaped rollers. So based on the output, that is the final product that we require, the rollers are suitably profiled. A rolling mill basically consists of rolls, bearings, a housing for holding the all these parts, and a drive motor for applying power to the rolls and controlling their speed. Rolling mills often vary in the type, number, and position of the rolls. The commonly used rolling mill arrangements in today's manufacturing industry include these five types. The first one is two high mill, next is three high mill, next we have four high mill, cluster mill, and finally tandem rolling mill. So rolling mills, you can see over here, this is the two high mill, the figure A. B is two high reversing mill, then C over here, you can see this is three high mill, then D is four high mill, and finally we have the cluster mill. So, and one more a special type of mill is called as a planetary mill. So rolling can also be classified based on these arrangements. So first we'll take up two high mill. So two high mill is the simplest of all the rolling mills, okay, as shown in figure over here. A will come to B at a later stage. The arrangement consists of two rolls, one at the top and one at the bottom, of equal diameters, and being rotated in a single direction. Once the rolling is completed, the rolled metal has to be returned back to the entrance. So once this complete rolling takes place, we are again going back and feeding it in the same direction. So this takes a lot of time and effort, so also resulting in low production rates due to time lost in returning the metal to the entrance of the mill. So this was overcome by using this two high mill, okay, with reversing option. So this two high mill with reversing is shown over here. You can see the mill can be rotated in both clockwise as well as in anti-clockwise direction. So the metal will move from left to right as well as from right to left. So the reversing and the production rate can be improved. If the two high reversing mill, the rotation of the rolls can be reversed, this enables the work to travel first through in one direction and then back through the other direction. Thus, a series of reductions can be made using the same set of rolls by passing it back and forth. However, the disadvantage of reversing mill is that the rolls must be stopped, reversed, and then brought back to the rolling speed between each pass. So this is one disadvantage. Next, we have three high mill. So this is the three high mill. This was used to overcome the disadvantage of this reversing concept. So over here you can see the metal is fed in between these two rollers. So you can see, observe the rotation of the middle mill, middle roller. So it is in a constant direction. So once this is fed, and again it will be fed again through these two, between these two rollers, the middle one and the top one. The three high mill consists of three rolls of equal size. The upper and the lower rolls are power driven, while the middle roll rotates by friction. So there is friction between the roller and the metal. So this will rotate based on the friction. The workpiece from the first pass, usually from the lower end, is fed to the upper roll for the second pass. So and then back again to the lower pair of the rolls for the third pass. So the rolled metal is passed back and forth between the roller and upper pairs, lower and upper pairs of the rolls, thereby achieving series of reductions without the need for roll reversing. So this disadvantage has been converted to advantage in the case of three high mills. So next is four high mills. You can see over here, this is four high mill. larger diameter rolls will have larger contact work area and hence requires great amount of roll force and energy for its operation. This can be overcome with the use of 4 high mills. Over here you can see there are 2 small diameter rolls. However, small diameter rolls have less strength and rigidity than the large rolls and hence must be supported by backup rolls. These are the 2 backup rolls. These are the small rolls. Very thin sheet can be rolled to very close tolerance with the use of such setup. Next we have cluster mills. So the diameter of backup rolls cannot be greater than 2 to 3 times in case of 4 high mills. So as the work roll diameter is decreased more and more to accommodate the process with exceedingly high rolling loads, the size of the backup roll also decreases. A point is reached when the back roll themselves begin to bend and must be supported. Hence, the ultimate design is the cluster mill. You can see over here, the size goes on increasing as it moves farther from the metal. The cluster mill uses small work rolls backed up by many large rolls. Such a setup can be used for cold rolling high strength materials to a very thin cross section. So next, over here you can see a schematic diagram of strip rolling on a 4 strand continuous mill. You can see over here the cross section is being reduced continuously. Strand 1, 2, 3 and 4. And this is also called as a tandem mill. A tandem mill, for example, consists of 4 strands through which the work material constantly passes through. So you can see it is constantly passing through. Each set of roll is called a strand. You can see strand 1, strand 2, 3 and 4. At each strand, the thickness of the workpiece is reduced to a certain extent. Reduction in strip size takes place successively and rolling is completed in a single pass. So this is a 4 high mill. You can see this is strand 1, 2, 3, 4. So you can see the cross section has greatly reduced with multiple passes. Next we have a planetary mill. You can see over here, this is the setup, planetary mill. We have a big roller and on that particular roll, there are multiple rollers. This is a special type of rolling mill used for very high reductions in a single pass. The planetary mill consists of a pair of heavy backup rolls surrounded by large number of small planetary working rolls. You can see over here, this is the backing roll and these are the planetary rolls. In working, as the workpiece metal is pushed into the roll gap, a pair of planetary rolls comes in contact with the work, causing reduction in its size. Since the planetary rolls sweep in a circular path, the smaller rolls which are in contact with the workpiece now loses its contact as it moves further, while the next pair of the roller roll comes into contact with a workpiece and repeats the reduction in size of the work. The overall reduction is summation of a series of small reductions by each pair of planetary rolls. So each pair will reduce the cross section as it passes through the rollers, between the rollers. So this is about the different types of rolling mills that are available. Next we have rolling variables. So as we had discussed in extrusion, there are various factors that affect the final rolled product. But over here, we are observing the 3 principal parameters. The first one is the roll diameter. Next, we have the friction between roll and workpiece and presence of front tension or back tension. So the roll diameter. The roll diameter is an important factor as it directly dictates the maximum possible reduction in the work thickness that can be achieved. Also, both rolling load and length of arc of the contact of the rolls increase with increasing roll diameter. This results in higher frictional forces, leading to higher energy and power requirements for rolling. With small diameter rolls supported with suitable backup rolls, it is possible to produce a greater reduction in thickness for the rolled products. So that is about the importance of roll diameter. Next, we have the friction between roll and the workpiece. So although the friction is necessary in pulling the workpiece into the roll gap, its presence in extreme conditions influences the quality as well as the economy of the process. So high friction means high rolling load and hence more power requirements. Also, there is a tendency of edge cracking of the work. So we'll be discussing about this particular edge cracking in defects. For cold rolling with lubricants, coefficient of friction can range from 0.05 to 0.1, while for hot rolling, the values ranges from 0.1 up to the sticking condition. Next, the front and back tension. So the effect of longitudinal tension on the work can minimize the rolling force required to reduce the thickness of the work. Higher the applied front or back tension, the lower is the roll suppression force, and hence less stretching the mill experiences, and hence the thinner the strip can be. Front tension may be created by controlling the torque on the coiler around which the roll sheet is coiled, while back tension may be produced by means of a braking system in the uncoiler that controls the speed of the uncoiler relative to the roll speed. The study of effect of sheet tension has shown that back tension is about twice as effective in reducing the rolling load compared to front tension. So if you are able to control the front and back tension using the coilers, you can effectively reduce the rolling load. Okay, and back tension has more importance compared to front tension. Okay, so with this we'll move on to defects in rolling. So these are the various defects that you can see in rolling. The first one is baby edges and zipper cracks caused due to bending of rolls. You can see over here, these are the wavy edges, and next we have zipper cracks. At the center we have some cracks just like a zip. Next we have edge cracking. You can see these were discussed, and finally alligator. So at the center you can see there is a cut. So edge crack is caused due to spreading. This can be prevented using vertical rolls, and alligatoring is caused due to severe friction between rollers and the workpieces. So since severe friction will tend the material to stick to the rollers, and the material starts opening up at the center, somewhat like a alligator mouth. Okay. Next we have residual stresses in rolling. Residual stresses may develop during hot as well as cold working. So in hot rolling, residual stresses may arise due to quenching after operation, and this results in formation of cracks. And this can be prevented by controlled cooling. Okay, so annealing is used. Whereas in cold rolling, more severe the residual stresses are more severe than hot rolling. Introduced during strain hardening. So this cold rolling can be introduced during strain hardening and can be prevented by intermittently annealing the workpiece and then again going with the rolling process. So with this we have covered the important variables of rolling process as well as the defects. Sir, would you like to discuss some more about practical perspective?
Thank you, Nikhil. See here, when we study any subject, it has to be studied with a sequence. For example, Nikhil sir highlighted about the defects in rolling, possible defects in rolling. When we say that defects in, these are the possible defects. And suppose you are asked to make an inspection setup for the rolled products, then you must know what are the defects, and for those defects to check, you will have to make the setups. That is one part. So unless you know what are the possible defects, you will not be in a position to set up the inspection. And remember one thing, all metal formed components are strictly inspected because there are inherent defects in them. And however, once the product comes to market, it is always free from the defects. This is what we have to maintain. I was referring to Mishra Dhatu Nigam. So in Mishra Dhatu Nigam, there is a one separate section called roll pass design. And roll pass design is a very interesting topic. A lot of design goes into it. Whatever you have studied in machine design, that comes over here. And this metal forming subject is not about just reshaping the metal. It has a lot of science. And whatever you have studied, everything comes into picture. For example, Nikhil sir has showed one metal forming machine. If somebody asks you what is the wattage of electrical motor for that, what is the wattage of electrical motor for that? Then you cannot just simply throw some number. For that you will have to have the specification. From the specification you have to estimate what is the force, what is the friction, what is total load coming on the mechanical system. Then again the efficiency. From all that you will finally arrive at the wattage of electrical motor. And then you have to add some other factor and come to that conclusion. So here you have to have the knowledge of electrical engineering also. Coming to the roll pass, you know, especially the rollers are pushed aside by the metal. When the metal flows, the rollers are pushed aside. And to support the rollers, you have the fluid power circuits. So here comes the application of fluid power also. So please don't address this subject only from the exemption point of view. Okay, rolling means this. Okay, that you should know. But you must know from all other angles also. This is for your information. Hope my information will be useful to you. And I will hand over the mic to Nikhil sir.
And the one important concept over here is roll camber. So what happens is, when a piece of metal is rolled between two rolls, the thickness is reduced as a result of compressive forces exerted by the rolls. Okay? As a roll exerts a vertical, sir said that they provide some supports to the rolls. Because the metal will push aside. Over here you can see this is a schematic of two rolls. Okay? If it is perfectly a cylindrical shaped roller, the metal will start pushing in vertical direction, and usually at the center the pushing force will be more rather than at the sides. So the output of your rolled product will not be the required flat surface, but instead it will be slightly bulged at the center. Okay? So in order to avoid this, we design the rollers in such a way. You can see over here there's a slight bulge at the center of the rollers. These are the rollers that I am talking about. There's a bulge at the center and cross section is reduced at the edges. You can see the edges, cross section is gradually reduced. So this helps in applying more force at the center and thereby producing a flat rolled product. Okay? So the rolls are ground in such a way that its diameter at the center is slightly larger than the edges. Okay, in sheet metal rolling practice, this camber is typically less than 0.5 millimeter on the roll diameter. So usually the rolls are not perfectly cylindrical. They have more cross-sectional area at the center and lesser cross-sectional area at the ends. So this is called as roll camber. Camber, C-A-M-B-E-R. Roll camber. So this is not part of the syllabus, but just information about the design of rolls. Sir, anything else? I think this would be sufficient. So with this, we conclude our presentation on rolling. So in the next class, we'll be discussing in detail about press tools. Some basic concepts, as well as we'll go in depth with the numericals. Many students have asked about the numericals, the solutions, etc. So with that, we'll conclude the chapter on rolling. So thank you, sir. Thank you.